survey the wondrous cross on which the Prince of Glory died. My riches gained, I count but loss, in poor content on all my Well, welcome back to Redeemed by Grace Fellowship. We are so happy to see you and happy to have you with us today as we have a great lesson as we continue in our study through the Pauline epistles. Specifically at this point, we are looking at 1 Corinthians. And so we've had some good study so far. If you missed any of our lessons, you can go out there and find them right here on this channel that you're subscribed to and go and see that. In fact, make sure, please, subscribe to this channel, whether you're looking watching on YouTube, whether you're watching on Rumble or listening to it on Spotify or any of your other favorite podcast audio. You'll want to make sure you're subscribed to it so that you never, never miss out on any of our lessons. And there's quite a few out there, so you'll want to check them all out. And also, we've been praying internally for 2024. And one of the things we're asking God for is for our YouTube channel, specifically, to go over 1,000 subscribers this year. And so be a big part of that. Please subscribe to our channel. Make sure you hit the thumbs up, the like button, so that it helps the algorithm. And also, please share it. Share it out to everyone so that everyone has an opportunity to hear the gospel or to engage in their own growth and maturity in their walk with Christ. And they have the opportunity to share the gospel. Exactly what Christ asks us to do as believers. So please do that. Now, you will find Redeemed by Grace Fellowship, not only on the three I've mentioned, the YouTube, Rumble, and Spotify, but you'll also find written material on Facebook in particular. So check out our Facebook page, but you'll find us on Instagram, you'll find us on TikTok, you'll find us on X/Twitter, whatever you want to call it today. You'll find us even on LinkedIn, as well as some things on Pinterest, picture-wise. So, please feel free to just follow us on everything, and you won't miss out on anything. That's the best way to do it, right? That's right. Well, before we get started in our lesson, and we'll start with an outline and kind of go through where we've been and where we're going and keep a track of where we're at on that outline. But let's start with a word of prayer. So pray with me, if you would. Mighty God, we're just so thankful that we could come together to open up your word. You have promise that where two or three or more are gathered in your name, that you'll be there as well. And that doesn't necessarily mean in person, but that means in unison. And so as we come together, even on a media platform such as the internet that we have, we pray, Lord, that you would bless and enrich our time together, that you would give us the grace to take out the clutter of the world in our minds and hearts and hear you speak directly to us, that we might mature and become closer to you, that we might hear the gospel for the first time and respond to that gospel, or that we might indeed utilize these lessons to encourage our friends and to reach out to them with the truth. We just pray for that, Lord. We again lift up the goal for 2024 for you, Lord, to do a miraculous work again, that this time that it would be with the YouTube channel, and that you would move us to 1,000 subscribers by the end of this year. That's a miraculous work that we lay at your feet, and according to your will, if it is your will, you'll make it so. And we thank you for that. So just bless our time together, Lord, as we open up your word and speak to our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen and amen. That's right. Well, let's go ahead and bring up on the screen here our, there we go, our not only lesson again, we're going to be looking at 1 Corinthians. We're picking up in chapter 3 and verse 18 where we left off in our last lesson. And we will continue through verse 13 of chapter 4 today as we look at that going forward. And so if you have a copy of God's Word, feel free to open up to that. If you don't have, that's okay. Hang on. Just follow us. You will get a chance to hear it or see it as well on the screen. So feel free to hang around because it's important that you do so. And so as we get into that, where have we been? Well, we first of all, as we started 1 Corinthians, but with an introduction to it. And so if you missed that, you can get out there again on the channels and find that, and you'll get to listen or watch it as well. But the introduction, paints the historical background of what's going on in this particular city, why is this letter being written, and those types of things. And we even looked at the biblical historical recording of it in Acts chapter 18. So that was important as well. So we laid that foundation in our introduction, and we began to get into that. And since the beginning of the book, Paul has been laying out this letter addressing some things that are going on in the church in Corinth, specifically some disunity that has come up within the church. And so he addresses that. And that specific thing is a continuing thing that continues on as we march forward, because what has happened is Paul obviously was there. He planted the church. He then at a certain point in time, he needed to get back to Ephesus. And he is in Ephesus right now. And he's receiving reports about what's going on in Corinth. And from that, he writes this letter back to him and addresses it. And then he is going to send some servants down there to work with them until he can get there. And then before he gets there, they're going to come back with another report. And that's what her second letter to the Corinthians is all about. So that's a fun one to see what changes between this. But some of the problem was is these people began to follow members of the church like heroes. So after Paul, there were several other great men that came through preaching the gospel. And they were, even though they were all preaching the same message and there was a unity there, the Corinthians, and part of this was their cultural background, was to look at the man. And we know a lot of churches in our society, even today, that look at the man more than they do the Christ. And so they begin to talk about, well, I follow Paul. Well, no, I follow Apollos. Well, I follow Cephas, which is Peter, because he made a trip there as well, had some influence. Or I follow Christ. So there was this disunity, and they began to really boast in this leader that they had, and it would begin to grow. And so he not only then began to talk about this disunity and addresses it, but then he talked about what is the need for unity. And we're still looking at that, and we'll complete that here today. But this disunity, and we're going to keep looking at it until he gets to the end of chapter 4. In fact, in chapter 4, he's also going to add now and take them from not only the need of unity, but now to look at the need for servanthood. Servanthood, and that is a need that we all need to have. Nobody should become too full of themselves within the leadership of the church. And he will outline that very well for us. From there, we'll be looking at immorality that's going on in the church. He's going to talk about some important issues such as marriage in the church, and liberty and worship, the roles of men and women in the church. He's going to talk about the Lord's Supper and that importance. Chapter 12, he's going to talk a lot about spiritual gifts and what they are and what they are not. And that'll be an interesting study when we get there as well, because there's some people that misuse what that is. And so we can get into talking about what they are from a biblical standpoint. And then we will also look at the hope of the church, which is the resurrection of Christ, the resurrection that we will spend with him in eternity. And he's going to give a charge to the church. It's going to talk about stewardship of that charge and what are we responsible for. And then he's going to close by talking about his personal plans and greetings to those that he loves and what his plans are in furthering the gospel. So that's an encouraging thing for us to take a look at the roadmap that we should be on as well in our lives as we go through this. So that is a pretty neat little outline that we have. Now, one of the things we've been enjoying as we've gone through these studies is talking about the importance to not only spend time studying the Word of God, and of course, time in prayer. And I know a lot of us say, yeah, duh, we all know that. We hear that all the time, right? And so not that we do it all the time, right? But if we admit it, but we hear that all the time. We know that that's what we should be doing. But one of the tools that we have with technology is now being able to listen to the Word of God read to us. And it's a fantastic study tool, because there's times that I've been studying stuff and the clutter of life comes into my mind and I'm thinking about, I got to do this, I got to do that. And I kind of miss something in my own study, and might be driving somewhere, or you might be going to work or doing something out in the yard or whatever it might be that you're doing. And all of a sudden, you put on an earbud or a headset or whatever device you use, and you play the Word of God, and it reads. You listen to what you were studying, and you go, wait a minute, I missed that. Wow. I got to think on that. That's pretty good. And that's exactly why we're going to utilize it. And I've gone through and I've recommended several of these apps that you could download onto your favorite device. Gateway Bible is a great one. It has a great study helps, commentaries, all the things where you're going through your study. You can put up five translations side by side and kind of look at those. You can look at the Greek and Hebrew if you'd like, even. That's not a problem if you read that. But you can do all those things and listen to the audio as well. Blue Letter Bible also is a fantastic one. In fact, that's the one we're going to use today. And we're going to continue using Blue Letter through this particular study. But it also it provides you with the audio that you can hear, but it has those same study helps and things that you can get into to really further your depth of what they're talking about in the scripture, as well as Gideon Bible app. And Gideon International, the same guys that put the Bibles in hotels and in the hospitals. And yes, they have an app that is fantastic. And I, in fact, you ought to just download all three, and because you can move it in between them all the time. So that's what we're going to utilize. And so if I've got this queued up right, we should start right close to verse 18. So if you're watching on YouTube or Rumble, you'll see it on the screen. If you're listening to this on Spotify or another podcast app, yeah, you will hear the audio. So here we go.
Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile. So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas, or the world, or life, or death, or the present, or the future. All are yours, and you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. Chapter 4. This is how one should regard us, as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found faithful. But with me, it is a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself. For I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendation from God. I have applied all these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, brothers, that you may learn by us not to go beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up in favor of one against another. For who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? Already you have all you want. Already you have become rich. Without us, you have become kings. And would that you did reign, so that we might share the rule with you. For I think that God has exhibited us apostles as last of all, like men sentenced to death, because we have become a spectacle to the world, to angels, and to men. We are fools for Christ's sake, but you are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You are held in honor, but we in disrepute. To the present hour, we hunger and thirst. We are poorly dressed and buffeted and homeless, and we labor, working with our own hands. When reviled, we bless. When persecuted, we endure. When slandered, we entreat. We have become and are still like the scum of the world, the refuse of all things.
All right. That's an interesting passages that we're going to get into today. And so let's set the scene and kind of begin to chew on these scriptures that we've just heard read. And we'll read them again as we get to, ready to break them down a little bit. But it's important. But again, Paul has been speaking to the Corinthians about this lack of spiritual discernment. I mean, this lack is seen as in their misconceptions about those who are fellow workers with God. I mean, Paul corrects them on the importance of working correctly for the Lord and not depending on humans or human wisdom. And last week, Paul began to outline three perceptions of the church by pointing out what the ministry is supposed to accomplish. The church is a family, and its goal is maturity. And the church is a field, and the goal is quantity. And today, we will complete portraying the church as a building and as the goal, that with the goal of quality as well. So that is where we're heading today. As we get in there, now Paul returns to this subject of wisdom. You remember we saw that before, where he talked about wisdom and that human wisdom was a folly and worthless, and that we needed to work subject ourselves to the wisdom of God. Well, he returns to that very subject of wisdom, and he warns the believers not to be deceived into thinking that the wisdom of this human age is sufficient for obtaining salvation and for building up the church of God. It's not. It absolutely is not. And my friends, we see that all the time in our churches. I don't know how many times in the ministry I've heard a search committee looking for a pastor that will say something like, using human wisdom, would say something like, we need to hire a young guy because we need more young families to join this church. Well, what are we thinking that for? What does that have to do with it? God has somebody in mind he wants there for his specific reason, and that's what we should be looking for. What do you want, God? Who is the person that you have selected for us? And we have to be, that's hard for us sometimes. We want to use this wisdom about these things that we want to do. And so as he returns to that, he's going to point it out. And rather, if any Christians at all think of themselves to be wise by this world's standards, the world, you know, is ruled by the prince of the air, who is Satan. Anybody wants to go by the world's standards, the world's culture, the things that are going on, as opposed to God, then we have an issue, and our issue is going to fail. But we must, friends, renounce dependence on that wisdom in order to really receive God's wisdom. And to prove this, Paul again mentions the truths that he spoke about back in chapter 1. I believe it was verses 18 through 25-ish. If you want to go back and take a look at that lesson, you'll see what we went into in detail there. But the seeming foolishness of preaching of the cross to them is what he was, in a nutshell, talking about. And it's really... is really God's true wisdom for salvation. That's what it is. The preaching of the cross and the foolishness that the world saw that as God's true wisdom for salvation. And so that's something that we need to really hang on to as we look forward. So let's get into this and let's start to chew on these verses a little bit and see what God would have us to know about them and talk about them a little bit. And again, at any time you have questions about any of what we're going over or something you need clarified, we do not put a live chat up here. We do not have a comment section down below because we do believe that you need to be unanimous and we need to be confidential with you. And so therefore, use our email address. And you see it right there on the screen now as going by on the scroll bar at the bottom, but I'll read it to you. It's rbgf22@yahoo.com. rbgf22@yahoo.com. In fact, some of you have already sent some questions over. ahead of this lesson as you were preparing for it today. And so I will ask those questions without giving your name, of course, but I'll ask those questions because they were great questions. And I think it's questions that a lot of us have asked. And so we will go through those as needed. So verses 18 through 20 read, "Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you thinks that he is wise in this age, let him become a fool that he may become wise. For the wisdom of this world is folly with God. For it is written, he catches the wise in their craftiness. And again, the Lord knows the thoughts of the wise, that they are futile." All right. So let's talk about that a little bit. Pretty directly and forcefully, Paul here declares that the wisdom of this world is foolishness in God's sight. And he uses two Old Testament scriptures to support this. The first is a free rendering of Job chapter 5, verses 12 and 13, which he applies in a special sense to God. And then the graphic word catches vividly portrays the idea that humans in their craftiness are no match for God. And sometimes we think we are. And they set up their schemes of salvation against God's. And so, it's the old saying, you're either with me or you're against me. And well, that's exactly kind of the point. But he catches them up kind of short there. And then his second quotation is from Psalm 94, verse 11, in fact, and showing that the Lord knows all the futile thoughts of the so-called wise men, and nothing that enters their minds is beyond his understanding. And that's not in tune with God's thoughts, and that's in vain. So we must also build according, friends, to the right plan. There's a lot of things that we have in our churches sometimes. Sometimes these are great programs we bring in. Sometimes we say we've always done it that way. These worked in the past, so work now. And a lot of times we put more faith in that program and just going through the motion, and I'm not knocking any of those things, such as a VBS or whatever it require versus this type stuff. You know, I'm not knocking any of those things, but what I am saying, sometimes we put more into that other than what is it that God wants us to do in our community here? What's he specifically giving this church that he's not giving the church down the street, but he's not giving us this that they're doing? You see how that thought can come in? And sometimes we vainly get involved with that, and that we must build according to the right plan, not how to build XYZ church, but how to build God's kingdom. And the world depends a lot on, you know, promotion and prestige and the influence of money and important people, of course. When we look at politics, that's all we see, right? And the church depends on prayer, the power of the Spirit, humility, sacrifice, and service. That's what the church depends on. That's the opposite of the world. It's not the prestige. The church that imitates the world may seem to succeed for a moment in time. It may seem to do that for a moment in time, but it will turn to ashes in eternity, and it's worthless. And that is important for us to really, really understand. Those that who defile the church and think they can succeed in destroying it by their human wisdom would be far better off to reject that wisdom and accept the foolishness of Christ's cross. With the quotations that we got here from Job 5 and Psalm 94 again, Paul reinforces his point from chapter 1 by again reminding them that human wisdom cannot save. Also can't either build a church. It can't build the church or prevent its growth. Human wisdom can't do that. And so that's kind of the foundation we start with today. So let's read verses 21 through 23. So let no one boast in men, for all things are yours, whether Paul or Apollos or Cephas or the world or life or death or the present or the future, all are yours. And you are Christ's, and Christ is God's. So finally, we must build with the right motive, as we've talked about it. And that motive is the glory of God. The members of the Corinthian church were glorifying men. And it was this wrong that they were comparing men and dividing the church by such carnal needs and deeds. They had been seeking to glorify God alone, there would have been harmony in the assembly, but there wasn't, because they were seeking things on human wisdom. I mean, the conclusion is that no Christian should be boasting or glorifying in human wisdom and attainments, not even those of Paul and Apollos. I mean, we think of them as great men, right? They're in the Bible. They did a lot of things. We should be even looking at them as great men. Why not? Well, because all the blessings of God and the whole universe belong to the redeemed church. So the ministry of Paul and Apollos, or Cephas, which is Peter, and any other Christian worker belongs to God's people. Did you hear me? We belong to God's people. And also the world itself, the processes of the living and dying, the present and the future, all must be viewed in relationship to God's purposes and plans for his redeemed people. So Paul can say, all things are yours, everything is for the believer's benefit and belong to them. Paul and Apollos and all the others received no credit for building the church. All believers share equality. That means you and I, as well as them, share equality in God's most important and valuable provisions and glories. Human boasting, therefore, is ludicrous, as well, my friends, as sinful. So what did, and this is one of the questions that one of you sent over, and by the way, these questions are great. We've talked about it before while we're doing studying, while we're studying the scripture. It's good to ask who, what, when, where, and why. Why is this mentioned here? What does this have to do with the price of beans in Boston, so to speak? I mean, what is the purpose of this at this particular moment, or whatever he is addressing? And so when you ask those questions, if you're, I hope you're keeping a journal when you're studying the Word of God and taking notes and things like that, but writing these questions down are important. Because even if you continue with your study, you can go back and then look those questions up to, and then ponder on those and to see what it is. Because it's the Word of God, and that wouldn't be there if God didn't speak it and have an importance and a purpose for it. So it's important for us to think about those. And so it's great when we come up with those questions that we have to get answers. So this one again was, what did Paul mean by all things are yours? All things. I mean, these verses look back to the church's factions and the slogans mentioned in chapter one again. Christians, because of their relationship to God through Christ, are heirs of all things, including the ministries of those who faithfully promote the gospel. And by cutting out one group or another from their fellowship, or by dismissing the work of a particular leader, they missed what that group or leader could offer. And it's absolutely useless to worry about who is more powerful or popular, if you will. And it's counterproductive, isn't it, to compete against one another as believers. And the Lord created us, friends, to work together, not to gain advantage over each other. He has given us a very good thing we have here. And we are to use all our gifts, resources, and talents for his glory and not our own. And thus, Paul wanted the Corinthians to see that their divisions were robbing them of God's greater work. I mean, knowing that believers belong to Christ and therefore to one another is the greatest incentive for unity in the church. And although the universe is now in Satan's grip, it's still the God-given and God-made possession of Christians. I mean, in the millennial kingdom and throughout eternity, however, believers will possess both the recreated and eternal earth in a infinitely more complete and rich way. I mean, all things aren't created in believers, for all things are actually and finally belong to God. They belong to Christians only as they themselves belong to God through the mediatorship of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. Christ and the Father are one, and yet Christ was sent by the Father into the world to effect our redemption so that we may inherit the kingdom of God. And as we move into chapter four, these verses follow up the preceding discussion about Christian workers that we've been hammering out here. And Paul adds that such servants of Christ must also be considered stewards of God to those whom a trust has been committed, a trust they're to be faithful to. Well, Paul answered the leaders of the various factions in the church when he called himself and Apollos mere servants of Christ. I mean, the word is literally under rowers, is what the word really means. And it described the slaves, basically, who rowed the huge Roman galleys. And Paul says, we're not the captains of the ship, but we're only the galley slaves who are under orders. Now, is one slave greater than another? Of course not. Of course not. And that's what he's beginning to play out. We're not to be idolized. We are a servant of God. And so let's look at the first two verses of chapter four. This is how one should regard us. as servants of Christ and stewards of the mysteries of God. Moreover, it is required of stewards that they be found faithful. Well, everyone should count Paul and other Christian workers as servants in Christ, very simply. And they're to be fully, because they're fully responsible to him, God, not to the Corinthians, not to our local communities, wherever you live, in New York City or Miami, Florida, Houston, Texas, wherever you might live, we're responsible to him. And the phrase, those entrusted with, it literally means house stewards. That's what the original language would actually mean, house steward. And it refers to the position often held by a slave entrusted with managing the affairs of a household. The secret things of God indicates these mysteries of salvation that God has revealed in his world, and things that one can't discover, one that can't be discovered by human wisdom at all. And these truths of the cross have been entrusted to Christian workers to be carefully used and guarded as a as subordinate servants of Christ. Friends, we have no right of authority over these truths, but must minister them in Christ's name to God's people. That's what we're trying to do with Redeemed by Grace Fellowship. And that's why we'd like to keep asking you and talking to you about subscribing and sharing and all that stuff, because that's exactly what we're trying to accomplish. But Paul wanted everyone to view him and his fellow ministries only as humble messengers. God ordained them that God ordained them to be, nothing more. And Paul defines his responsibilities as an apostle by using the word originally referring to a person entrusted with the responsibility for his master's entire household. You know, buildings and fields and finances and food and other servants, and sometimes even the children of the elder. It was not uncommon that it was that slave that was what we would call a teacher that taught public education, math and history and all those things. That would have been known as that. Remember, this society in Corinth is a very well-to-do place because of where it sits and crossing over from one sea to the other. Sitting right in the middle of that, which now there's a canal that goes through there. But before, it was a point where they would land their ship, roll it across the land to the other side, and get back in. Either that or it would take them months to go around by sea. So that's something that was very, very important. So again, Paul examines the character of those that are handling God's truth. They include not only himself, but most, we must all show ourselves faithful. And since he is the Lord's servant and steward, it is to the Lord that he owes responsibility. And it's the Lord who judges him for the quality of his service. And human judgment has very little value. Even self-evaluation is unreliable. Christ is Lord of the conscience and the one who can evaluate it properly. Evaluate it properly. Well, let's take a look at verses 3 and 4. But with me, it's a very small thing that I should be judged by you or by any human court. In fact, I do not even judge myself, for I am not aware of anything against myself, but I am not thereby acquitted. It is the Lord who judges me. Well, Paul isn't saying that he's above fellow ministers or other Christians or even certain unbelievers. He's saying that a human verdict on his life is not the one that matters, even if it was his own self-perspective. Paul wasn't aware of any unconfessed habitual sin in his own life, but his limited understanding assumed that he wasn't the final verdict. And Paul's own sincere evaluation of his life didn't acquit him of all the failures to be faithful. He's the ultimate and the only qualified judge, he being God, of any of man's obedience and faithfulness. I mean, the responsibility of the steward, again, is to be faithful to his master. A steward may not please the members of the household. He may not even please some of the other servants, but if he pleases his own master, he's a good steward. And the most important judgment is God's judgment. And certainly God judges us today through his word and by the ministry of the Spirit. And sometimes he uses the ministry of a loving friend to help us face and confess our sin. But the main reference here is to the final evaluation when each Christian stands the judgment seat of Christ. Then the true facts will be revealed and the faithful servants rewarded. Let's look at verse 5. Therefore, do not pronounce judgment before the time, before the Lord comes, who will bring to light the things that are now hidden in darkness and will disclose the purposes of the heart. Then each one will receive his commendation from God. Well, Paul leaps forward to the return of Christ here, that when all Christians will have their works examined at the judgment seat of Christ. And because of this, he charges the Corinthians and us as well not to judge his faithfulness. For this can be done truthfully only by the Lord when he returns. Therefore, knowing that the Corinthians were already judging him and others, he says to them, in fact, curb your habit of judging. Stop it. What is hidden in darkness? Are the acts and motives concealed in the inner recesses of a person's mind and heart? In Hebrew poetic style, Paul says, the Lord will expose the motives of men's hearts as an explanation of his statement. He will bring to light that which is hidden in the darkness. And thus, at the second coming of Christ, those who have been faithful in their work with the Lord will receive praise from him. As the final judgment must be done by God, so one's final praise will come from him. And these refer to their inner motives, their thoughts, and their attitudes, which only God can know, since final rewards will be based and not just on outward service, but on inward devotion. Only God can give the praise of each person deserves. So another question that was sent over, which is perfect right here. Why should we judge nothing before the appointed time? Well, this refers to a kind of a judgment that will take place on the day when the Lord, the day of the Lord, when eternal destinies will be decided. And though we as believers can and should be accountable to each other for our attitudes and behavior, we can't prejudice the final salvation of another. can't do that. That's up to God. And friends, none of us are in position to access the motivations of the human heart, especially when it comes to another service to the Lord. And while the Bible does instruct us to react in a certain way to sinful behavior, we're not to judge anyone's intentions. Often our opinion of their actions has more to do with their own feelings and failings than theirs. And that's important for us to really remember. That's called, looking in the mirror, maybe? Yeah. All right. Let's look at verse 6. I have applied all these things to myself and Apollos for your benefit, brothers, that you may learn by us not to go beyond what is written, that none of you may be puffed up in favor of one against another. So Paul describes the difference between himself and Apollos and some of the other Christian leaders. The Corinthians, he says, were proud and claimed to be spiritually rich. On the other hand, Paul and Apollos were considered weak and were more despised and persecuted by the world. And that's true. And we do see people in Christendom that will bang on their chest about how great they are, that they're a huge, big leader. And sometimes we tell them that they are wrongfully when they are a servant in the gallows. And so what Paul has said about not judging or misjudging Apollos or himself, he once understood as applying to the Corinthians' attitude towards all of God's people, that they shouldn't take pride in some and despise others. And referring to this misconception on their part, the apostle may be alluding to the real leaders of the faction parties for whom the other names. But Paul, Apollos, Peter, Christ, those words were substituted for these other leaders even. Or he may have been simply referring to some who were responsible for stirring up this misconception about how God's minister should be viewed. I'm not saying that our pastors are not to be honored and revered, for they are. But we also must understand that they too are human. They too are sinful men. They too struggle. They too need to be lifted up. And if we're members of a church, we have that responsibility. They're not to be these high and mighty guys that we go in, sit in a pew, listen to deliver this great speech and compliment on how great they did and go home and never think about it again. We'll see you next Sunday. It's not what God's called us to do. In the expression that we see here, I have applied these things to myself and Apollos. Paul says he's teaching the Corinthians by personal illustration that ministers are only examples rather than merely teaching them by abstract principles. The saying, "Do not go beyond what is written," contains the familiar phrase often used here to introduce Old Testament quotations. So it's interesting that he's using that phrase. Again, you could be asking why. But Paul's advising the Corinthians not to go beyond any written doctrine in the Old Testament. Don't add to it. Don't do anything different. And then this last cause, or last clause that we see in verse 6, kind of like the preceding clause, was one of result and fits into the context as follows. If they learn not to go beyond the teaching of the scripture and about how they should treat God's teachers and all of God's people, then the result will be that they will not be conceited in taking a stand for one teacher or one person over or against another. Important, important. The Corinthians, that doesn't mean we don't have disagreements. Okay, let me add that in there. It doesn't mean we don't have disagreements, but it does mean there's a unity about it. And sometimes it's, the disagreement means that there needs to be some time with each other, praying for each other, and reconciling with each other. But the Corinthians, you know, they're measuring up different ministries by their own personal preferences and prejudices. And each group in the church was tearing down the other's preacher in order to build up the man they liked. And their motive was not at all spiritual. They were promoting division in the church by being partisan to one man over the others. And they needed to examine their own hearts and to get rid of the pride that was destroying the church. So how does Paul deal with that? Well, let's look at verses 7 and 8 to start with. For who sees anything different in you? What do you have that you did not receive? If then you received it, why do you boast as if you did not receive it? Already you have all you want. Already you have become rich. Without us, you have become kings. And would that you did reign so that we might share the rule with you. Okay, let's dig into that. Some Christians evidently were boasting because of their talents and positions and parties. So Paul puts an end to the rhetorical question to them. What do you have that you did not receive? And the obvious answer is that they received everything from God and had no right to boast. And that's what he's digging at here. And therefore, derides their conceit by a series of dramatic boasts of theirs. They think, have all they need. They're rich, which the Corinthians were very rich. And they were reigning like kings, as they were used to living in that fashion, even without any help from Paul. They didn't need Paul. They didn't need Apollos. They didn't need that for those things to happen. They were already there as far as a human wisdom situation. And the Corinthians evidently had thought that they had reached full maturity in Christianity and were ruling and reigning rather than walking humbly with God. Friends, pride is deception. It is a deception since everything a person possesses is from God's providential hand. All of it. Paul used a bit of sanctified, if you will, sarcasm in verse 8. That's exactly what he's pouring on, sarcasm there. When he described the Corinthians as kings. I mean, there's no place for pride in the ministry. Church members were wrong when they measure ministers other than by the standards that God's given them. They're also wrong when they boast about their favorite preachers. or leaders in the church. I mean, this isn't to say that faithful servants can't be recognized and honored again, but in all things, God must be glorified. And Paul genuinely wished it were, it really were the coronation time of the millennium, so that they all might share in the glory of the Lord. And in an ultimate sense, human arrogance makes very little sense, because we never accomplish anything except using the gifts and talents and energies and inspirations and even the breath from our lungs that God gives us. Let's take a look at the next few verses here. Verses 9 through 10. For I think that God has exhibited us apostles as last of all, like men sentenced to death, because we have become a spectacle to you, to the world, to angels, and to men, who are fools for Christ's sake. But you are wise in Christ. We are weak, but you are strong. You were held in honor, but we disrepute. So continuing the irony, if you will, Paul replies that, in his opinion, God hasn't placed the apostles in a reigning position such as the Corinthians think themselves are in. And the irony is that Corinthians were trying to reign as kings while their spiritual fathers and examples were far from reigning. And actually, Paul goes on to explain that God has publicly displayed the apostles as humble, despised men, men worthy of death. I mean, if we go and look, follow in Paul specifically through his three missionary journeys, man, he's been left for dead. He's been exiled. He's been run out of here. He's been jailed. Everything, all kinds of suffering that's come along that for the sake of Christ. It's not the life of a luxurious king that he's living by far, right? And so that's an important thing. I mean, he pictures those of the apostolic band, if you will, as condemned to death and led forth by a conqueror. I mean, the word spectacle that he uses there alludes to the figure of a condemned man that are tortured and exposed to the wild animals in the Colosseum. This is language that they know in their time frame that we might not catch on to. I mean, they're despised for both of the whole world and the angelic hosts. I mean, condemned prisoners, what am I talking about? Something that they understood? Well, condemned prisoners were brought into a Roman arena to fight and die. The last ones brought in out for the slaughter were for the grand finale, if you will. And in his sovereign wisdom for his ultimate glory, God chose to display the apostles figuratively before men and angels during the present age as just such worthless and condemned spectacles. Doomed like gladiators, they were ridiculed, spit on, imprisoned, beaten. And yet God glorified his name through them as he used them to build his kingdom. That's it. That's the bottom line right there, friends. I mean, Paul's been making this series of contrasts between proud Christians and the dishonored apostles, all from the warped viewpoint of the Corinthians, the world, if we will. And what a contrast. The apostles, foolish, weak, and dishonored, and the Corinthians, wise, or the world, if you want to substitute the world, the wise, the strong, and the honored. And again, using sarcasm, Paul rebukes him. And this time, on himself, as if mimicking the attitude of the proud Corinthians towards him. He does that. And so the Corinthians are wise in their own eyes, but they were actually fools in the sight of God. And by depending on the wisdom and standards of the world, they were acting like fools. And the way to be spiritually wise, my friends, is to become a fool in the eyes of the world. That's what you and I are doing. The Corinthians were arguing amongst themselves about who they had the right view of, who had the right view of doctrine, which was really an attempt to distinguish themselves and to claim power in the church. I mean, Paul explained he sought no earthly honor, nor could a Christian success come from worldly definitions. Jealousy is a deadly combination of fear and pride. We all know that. And we become concerned when concerned that another has been blessed or is respected more than we are sometimes. That's why we have the God talks to us about envy, doesn't he? But scripture is clear. This is not God's best for us. He wants us to be focused on his will and not what others have or do. And when our hearts are set on him, friends, we will have all that we need or want. Let's look at verses 11 and 13 as we are getting close to the end here. To the present hour, we hunger and thirst. We are poorly dressed and buffeted and homeless. We labor, working with our own hands. We revile, we bless when persecuted. We endure when slandered, we entreat. We have become and are still like the scum of the world, the refuse of all things. I mean, this was the crux of the whole matter, wasn't it? I mean, the Christians in Corinth wanted the honor that comes from men and not the honor that comes from God. They were trying to borrow glory by associating themselves with these great men. And so Paul answered as if to say, if you associate with us, you better be ready for suffering. We apostles aren't held in honor. We're despised. And Paul knew that. And we reading about Paul, and we'll see it over and over is in this particular study of his letters where that is so true. But you also see it in the book of Acts as well. So if you haven't checked that out, do that as well. But Paul then described the hardships and suffering that he had to endure as a servant of God. I mean, Paul describes in detail the hardships he had and his fellow Christian workers have suffered throughout their ministry. He first emphasizes the physical deprivations that were suffering, like hunger and thirst and lack of clothing and rough treatment and homeless. And then to remind the Corinthians that, and us, again, that he has no desire to be a physical burden on them, he injects the statement. Now, this one is a 2x4 hitting them upside the head. We work hard with our own hands. And he continues mentioning mainly the verbal abuse that he and his friends took in their response to it. They were frequently reviled, but they called on God to bless their revilers. When persecuted, they endured it, and when slandered, they answered kindly. And climaxing this moving passage, Paul states that he and his fellow workers have become like the scum of the earth. And the apostles and early preachers lived at the lowest levels of society. I mean, while the Corinthian believers thought that they were kings, the apostle knew that he was a suffering slave. That's what Paul knew, as did the others. And the apostles did manual labor, which Greeks, including a lot of them there in Corinth, considered beneath their dignity and suitable for only slaves. But Paul wasn't resentful about any necessary labor needed to support the gospel preaching. I mean, the scum and residue, scrap from all the dirty dish or garbage pot, figuratively used of, is a word that's figuratively used of the lowest and most degraded criminals who often were often sacrificed in pagan ceremonies, not in God's sight, but in the world's. And Paul and his fellow preachers were so designated. And what a rebuke of the proud carnal Corinthians who saw themselves at the top, while the humble Apostle Paul considered himself the bottom. And that's a remarkable thing. It really is. And that's where you and I should be friends. Not to be thinking too highly of ourselves or look what we can do or what we can't do. You know, those spiritual gifts, when we get to that in chapter 12, you're going to see that you're given gifts and it's not your talents. You're given gifts you don't even know you have or can do, that while you're serving, boom, something's going to come out of your mouth or an action that you're going to go, where'd that come from? The answer is God. It's important. There's no person in our church that's more important than another. Pastor is not important to the person that sets up tables and chairs for a meal. It's truth. We all have the same responsibility. That's to tell the world about Jesus Christ. My friend, I hope you know Jesus Christ. If you don't, please send me an email at rbgf22. With any questions you have, I'll be glad to try and answer each and every one for you. And if you have accepted the Lord as your Savior, rbgf22@yahoo.com. I'd love to hear your testimony. I'd love to celebrate that with you. Boy, please do. You know, you might be someone that would like to be part of this ministry. And if you are, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send us an email. Let us know what you're thinking. We need to prayerfully get together on that and see what it is that you're wanting to do. I don't know. Maybe you're a technology guru, because I'm not. Maybe you can help us grow and do things better. Maybe you're a musician, or maybe you're a person that likes to work with ladies and women's ministry, lady on lady, doing ministry with women, or working with kids or youth or whatever it is. Maybe you're a teacher. Maybe you can do a devotion. Maybe you're good at leading a prayer meeting or praying. rbgf22@yahoo.com. Let's talk. Let's talk about that. Well, next week we are going to be looking at the continuation of chapter 4. So starting in verse 14, where we left off, and going to verse 13 again in chapter 5. So we'll be looking at those verses. So if you get a chance to take a look at that up front, and you have questions as you're going through your pre-study, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send them over. We'll try and include some of them as we can. Or if we don't answer your question in the thing, we definitely want to make sure that we do that. Please send those over as well as we do that. Now, you will find on YouTube or Rumble or Spotify, or you will find some other studies of ours. And some of these might not be on Spotify yet, but that's okay. YouTube and Rumble, you'll find them all. You can go back and see a study as we went through the Gospel of John, just like we're doing now. We went through the Gospel of John. It's a neat one to go through. We also did a study through the Book of Acts, doing the same thing, walking through the Book of Acts. In fact, one of you sent over an email for a suggestion on a new class in that course. And by the way, if you have a suggestion for a future study, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send it over. Let us pray on that. They were asking for a course about basics in Christianity. Well, there you go. Fundamentals of faith. Awesome. Every one of you should be going and checking that out. And there's even a little short Christmas series that came through. Trying to remember the text of the email said something like, every Christmas we hear all about the birth of the Christ child as it is presented in the New Testament. What does the Old Testament have to say about it? 400 years before that, what did the Old Testament have to say? So we had a little short Christmas series then, Christmas of Old. So you can check that out as well if you like on that. But again, if you have ideas for a future study, please rbgf22@yahoo.com. Now, if you have kids or grandkids, well, this is one that we'll be going into our second year this year of offering. And it's a short little sermonette each week. It's about 15, 20 minutes long. And these kids get an opportunity to hear the gospel. They get a chance to learn a little bit about Jesus. They get to have some fun. So it is a little bit interactive as well. And so they enjoy that. They get a little music and marching around the room and singing a little bit. All kinds of stuff that's in there. But it's a short little lesson each week. They get a video with it. Please check that out. It's a good time if you're doing your family devotions and you're looking for something to do with your kids. Man, just pop that up there. If you can pull YouTube up on your TV set or whatever, or your computer, whatever you want to put up, you could sit there and play that, and they could watch it and give you material to talk about and to fill in, talking about that study each and every week. And we've done some adjustments on it over the year, and hopefully it's getting better and better. But if you have any ideas as well, rbgf22@yahoo.com, and we'll be glad to go from there. So, absolutely. Well, friends, I've had a good time with you today. I hope you've enjoyed the lesson as well. Know that we love you, and we are praying for you. So please pray for us as well. Please make sure that you subscribe, like, and share, not only on this particular channel, but on all our platforms, and do that so that we can help take the gospel around the world. Remember, friends, that Redeemed by Grace Fellowship is not meant to be a replacement or a substitute for a local church. It's very important you understand that. God created the church for a specific reason. It's the body of Christ. And we all need to be part of a local church. And so if you are not part of a local church and you have no idea what you should be looking for in a church, rbgf22@yahoo.com, send it over. We'll be glad to give you biblical criteria that you should be checking out. The way the world checks out a church. So what does the church have to offer me? Do they have the music I like? Do they have things for my kids? Not that those things aren't important, But the question we have to be asking is, where, God, do you want me to serve? So if you're not sure what you need to be looking at from criteria standpoint to align yourself with a true, genuine Christian church, then shoot that email or we'll send it to you. In fact, if you let us know where you live, we'll maybe send you a list of some churches in that area that you need to go check out. I've never been there. You go check out and prayerfully spend time with that. And if you need consultation for any reason, whether it's a marriage or a drug, substance abuse, grieving, whatever it is that you might be having, if you're seeking shelter from abuse, rbgf22@yahoo.com. Let's be confidential with that. So send it over and we'll do our best to get you. So I want to pray for you, and then we will see you next week, and we'll leave listening to the rest of the wonderful cross. So let's pray together. Almighty God, again, we're so thankful we could get together today to open up your word, to learn from you, to be with each other. Paul just really makes us stop and think about things from his eyes, because a lot of times we get our hearts stubborn and fastened. It's my way or the highway kind of stance that we take. And it's the same thing the Corinthians were doing. And yet we're to look at ourselves as servants. And because we're serving the Lord and what we're doing, it's a way of worship, and it's a way that we are to honor you, as opposed to just things that we're doing for our own glory. So we pray, Holy Spirit, that you would convict us where we've gone wrong in that, and that you would restore us as we repent, and then you would strengthen us in a humble heart that seeks Christ. And we thank you. We praise you. We love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Friends, again, we love you. You have a good week, and we'll see you then.